How you doing?
Thank you.
Let us begin. Comrades, this day is sacred with the almost visible presence of those who have gone before us. We honor the memory of those who gave their lives in the service of our country, and of those others who have dropped their burdens by the wayside of life and are gone now to their eternal rest. May the ceremonies of today deepen your reverence for our dead. Let us renew our pledge of loyalty to our country and its flag. Let us resolve by word and deed to emphasize the privilege and duty of patriotism. Chaplain.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, Father of all, amidst these monuments of the dead, we see thy hand. In the depth of our sorrow, we realize the truth of the inspired words. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. As comrade after comrade departs, we march on with ranks grown thinner. Help us to be faithful unto thee and to one another. We beseech thee, look in mercy upon all of us here assembled, and with thine own tenderness, console and comfort those bereaved by the hand of death. Heavenly Father, bless our country with freedom, peace, and righteousness, and may we all meet at last before thine throne of grace in heaven, and to thy great name shall be praised forever and ever. Amen.
At this time, our keynote speaker, Ray Daly from the Marine Corps League and Christmas for Kids. Ray.
Thank you all for coming out on this day of remembrance. I would like to explain the men and women who serve our country. The ones we honor today who gave their life for America. I believe the following story tells the soul of the American fighting men and women better than I could possibly tell it. 11 years ago, two United States Marines from very different walks of life met for the first time when they were put on guard duty at 7:30 in the morning. Just minutes later, the pair of Marines guarding a gate in Ramadi, Iraq, were staring down a large blue truck packed with 2,000 pounds of explosives. They could have sought cover like an Iraqi policeman on the scene who ran away and lived. Instead, Lance Corporal Jordan Harder and Corporal Jonathan Yale stood their ground. Their split-second choice saved the lives of 50 men. In 2010, then Lieutenant General John Kelly told Lance Corporal Jonathan Harder's and Corporal Jonathan Yale's story to a packed house. He did this just 4 days after he had lost his own son Robert to combat in Afghanistan. He spoke of the 9/11 attacks, the enemy that America was fighting, and praised the brave men and women who had volunteered to go overseas since then. Then he moved to the remarkable story of these two Marines, which he told the crowd showed the quality of steels in their backs. Here's what he said. 2 years ago, when I was the commander of all U.S. and Iraqi forces, in fact, the 22nd of April, 2008, two Marine infantry battalions, 1-9, the Walking Dead, and 2-8, were switching out in Ramadi. One battalion in the closing days of their deployment, going home very soon. The other just starting its 7-month combat tour. Two Marines, Corporal Jonathan Yale and Lance Corporal Jordan Harder, 22 and 20 years old respectively. One from each battalion, were assuming the watch at the entrance gate of the outpost that contained a makeshift barracks housing 50 Marines. The same broke-down ramshack building was also home to 100 Iraqi police, who were also my men and our allies in the fight against the terrorists in Ramadi, a city until recently the most dangerous city on earth and owned by Al-Qaeda. Yale was a dirt-poor mixed-race kid from Virginia with a wife, daughter, a mother, and a sister who lived with him that he supported on $23,000 per year. Harder, on the other hand, was a middle-class white kid from Long Island. They were from two different worlds. Had they not joined the Marines, they would have never met each other or understood that multiple Americas exist simultaneously, depending on one's race, educational level, economic status, and where you might have been born. But they were Marines, combat Marines, forged in the same crucible of Marine training, and because of this bond, they were brothers as close or closer than if they were born of the same woman. The mission orders they received from the sergeant squad leader, I am sure, went something like this. Okay, you two clowns, stand this post and let no unauthorized personnel or vehicles pass. You clear? I am also sure Yale and Harder then rolled their eyes and said in unison something like, "Yes, Sergeant," with just enough attitude that made the point without saying the words. No kidding, sweetheart. We know what we're doing. They then relieved two other Marines on watch and took up their post at the entry control point of Joint Security Station NASA in the Sofia section of Ramadi, Andahar, Iraq. A few minutes later, a large blue truck turned down the alleyway, perhaps 60 to 70 yards in length, and sped through the serpentine of concrete Jersey walls. The truck stopped just short of where the two were posted and detonated, killing them both catastrophically. 24 brick masonry houses were damaged or destroyed. A mosque 100 yards away collapsed. The truck's engine came to a rest 200 yards away, knocking most of a house down before it stopped. Our explosive experts reckon the blast was made of 2,000 pounds of explosives. The two died, and because these two young infantrymen didn't have it in their DNA to run from danger, they saved 150 of their Iraqi and American brothers in arms. When I read the situation report about the incident a few hours after it happened, I called regimental command for details of something about this struck me as different. The Marines dying or being seriously wounded is commonplace in combat. We expect Marines, regardless of rank, MOS, to stand their ground, do their duty, and even die in the process, if that is what the mission takes. But this just seemed different. The regimental commander had just returned from the site and he agreed, but reported that there were no American witnesses to the event, just Iraqi police. I figured if there was any chance of finding out what happened, and then to decorate the two Marines to acknowledge their bravery, I'd have to do it as a combat award that requires two eyewitnesses. We figured the bureaucrats back in Washington would never buy Iraqi statements. If it had any chance at all, it had to come under the signature of a general officer. I traveled to Ramadi the next day and spoke individually to a half a dozen Iraqi police, all of whom told the same story. The blue truck turned down into the alley and immediately sped up as it made its way through the serpentine. They all said they knew immediately that they were going on as soon as the two Marines began firing. The Iraqi police then related that some of them also fired, and then to a man, ran for safety just prior to the explosion. All survived, many were injured, some seriously, but the Iraqis elaborated and with tears welling up, said they'd run like any normal man would to save his life. What he didn't know until then, he said, and what he learned that very instant, was that Marines are not normal. Choking past the emotion, he said, "Sir, in the name of God, no sane man would have stood there and done what they did. No sane man. They saved us all. But we didn't know at the time and only learned a couple of days later, after I wrote a summary and submitted both Yale and Harder for Navy crosses, was that one of our security cameras, damaged initially in the blast, recorded some of the suicide attacks. It happened exactly as the Iraqis had described it. It took exactly 6 seconds from when the truck entered the alley until it detonated. You can watch the last 6 seconds of their young lives. Putting yourself in their hands, or their heads, I suppose it took about a second for the two Marines to separately come to the same conclusion about what was going on once the truck came into their view at the far end of the alley. Exactly no time to talk it over or call the sergeant to ask what they should do. Only enough time to take half a second and think about what the sergeant told them to do only a few minutes before. Let no unauthorized person pass. The two Marines had about 5 seconds left to live. It took maybe another 2 seconds for them to present their weapons, take aim, and open up. By this time, the truck was halfway through the barriers and gathering speed the whole time. Here, the recording shows the number of Iraqi police, some of whom had fired their AKs, now scattered like the normal and rational men they were. Some running right past the Marines. They had 3 seconds left to live. For about 2 seconds more, the recording shows the Marines firing nonstop, the truck's windshield exploding into shards of glass as their rounds take it apart and tore into the body of the son of a bitch who was trying to get past them to kill their brothers. American Iraqis bedded down in the barracks, totally unaware of the fact that their lives at that moment depended entirely on two Marines. They had been aware that he would have known they were safe because two Marines stood there between them and a crazed suicide bomber. The recording shows the truck careening to a stop immediately in front of the two Marines. In all the simultaneous violence, Yale and Harder never hesitated. By all reports, by the recording, they never stepped back. They never started to step aside. They never even shifted their weight. With their feet spread shoulder-width apart, they leaned into the danger, firing as fast as they could their weapons. They had only 1 second to live. The truck explodes. The camera goes blank. Two young men go to their God. 6 seconds. Not enough time to think about their families, their country, their flag, or about their lives, or their deaths. But more than enough time for two very brave young men to do their duty into eternity. This is the type of people who are on watch all over the world for you. Once again, thank you all for coming.
time will the band please play the national anthem? Step forward, our oldest veteran here today, will place a wreath. The police chief and fire chief, please come forward. Fraternal Order of Eagles and Auxiliary, please.
Each Memorial Day, we strive to bring into this community the very spirit of the services held at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. We do not know the eminence of his birth, but we do know the glory of his death. So granite walls guard eternally the body of the patriot who served and died. Whether he was Catholic, Protestant, or Jew, native born or adopted son is not of record. Whether he come from a humble home or one of wealth, a place where inland rivers flow or from where an ocean lays, no one knows. But each mother whose son's name is marked on our country's roster, place a burial unknown, may with equal justice claim as her own the patriot who sleeps in this sacred tomb. Every mother who gave a life for the flag has a right to share in the glory that hallows this mausoleum. Every person in whose heart the flames of patriotism glow is ever mindful of the sacrifices that gave us this glorious heritage. Let us here highly resolve that our dead shall not have died in vain.
Mayor Collins, would you like to place a carnation for the village, please? I will place one for the Sons and the Legion Auxiliary. Scout leaders, please. Please stand for the Star Spangled Banner. Sorry about that. Please stand for 30 seconds of silence in solemn memory of all of our fallen veterans. Comrades, on this Memorial Day, let us pledge ourselves anew to patriotic service. Let us make ourselves the friend and brother, son and father of those who will not see their own again in mortal flesh. Let us grasp with fearless hands the flag so nobly borne before, and like those others, plant it always on the battlements of righteousness. All who stand with us today, will you not consecrate yourselves with us to emulate their sacred service, that those who rest in heroes' graves may not have died in vain? Firing squad, honor our comrades who have fallen. Thanks everyone for coming. That concludes our services for today. There is a special ceremony over at Smith Funeral Home. Please, all are welcome to attend. Thank you.